Hello to all. Today we are going to study about the structure of the anther. And we must know that anther is surrounded by four layers, which are also called as the wall layers, or we can also call it as parietal layers. And if we see the structure of the anther, then from outside to inside, the anther is surrounded by four layers. Number one is epidermis. Number two layer is endothecium. Number three are the middle layers. And number four is the tapetum. So from outside to inside, anther is surrounded by four layers, known as parietal layers or wall layers. Epidermis, endothecium, middle layers and tapetum. Now, number one, epidermis. As you know very well, that you can see in the diagram that it is the outermost layer surrounding the anther. It is single cell thick. It is not multi-layered. It is single cell thick. You can see in the diagram. Now, it is not archiesporeal in origin. Remember this thing, that out of the four layers surrounding the anther, the three layers except the epidermis, known as the endothecium, middle layers and tapetum, are archiesporeal in origin. Are archiesporeal in origin means they are formed from an archiesporeal cell. But this epidermis layer, epidermis is not archiesporeal in origin, point to be noted here. And wherever the epidermis is present, you know very well that epidermis is the outer covering and it acts as a protective layer. Means the role of this epidermis is to give protection to the anther. Fine. Now, in archaeotherium is a small leafless parasitic angiosperm. Archaeotherium is the smallest leafless parasitic angiosperm. But in archaeotherium, fibrous thickenings are present. What is the special feature of the archaeotherium? That in archaeotherium, certain fibrous thickenings are present in the epidermis. And that's why in archaeotherium, the epidermis is called as exothecium. The epidermis is called as exothecium. Are you getting? Now, coming to the second layer, known as the endothecium. This is the endothecium, what I have shown here. I can say that endothecium is present below the epidermis and above the middle layers. Or I can say that endothecium layer is present between epidermis and middle layers. And this endothecium is very, very important layer found in the anther. Okay. And this endothecium shows certain changes right up to the maturity. It shows certain changes right up to the maturity. See here, endothecium is again single cell thick layer, just like the epidermis. It is also single cell thick layer. It is present below the epidermis and above the middle layers. Now, the outer wall of the cells of endothecium. Now, remember this thing. The outer wall of the cells of endothecium are thin, but the inner walls as well as the radial walls become thick due to the thickening of alpha cellulose fibers, due to the thickening of alpha cellulose fibers. So remember one thing, that certain fibrous thickenings are present made of alpha cellulose on the radial walls and on the inner walls of the endothecium. But remember this thing, this fibrous thickenings of the alpha cellulose are not found on the outer wall of the endothecium cells. Not only the alpha cellulose fibers are present on the endothecium, but callose bands are also present along the radial walls. Callose is a sort of a carbohydrate. So callose bands are also present along the radial walls. Right? Now, at some places, remember this thing, that in endothecium, there are few places where the fibrous thickenings of alpha cellulose and callose bands are absent. Again, I am repeating, there are some places, right, where the callose bands, whereas the callose bands and the fibrous thickenings are absent, and these places on the endothecium are called as the stomium, are called as the stomium, and stomium is the place from where the anther dehiscence takes place. You know what is dehiscence? We know very well that inside the anther pollen sacs are present, okay, and the pollen sacs are filled with the pollen grains. As soon as the anther matures, the anther bursts and the pollen grains comes out. But the question arises that if the anther is surrounded by four layers, then how the anther burst or it dehusk? So anther dehusk at a particular place known as the stomium. And you can see that stomium are the places where the fibrous thickenings of alpha cellulose and callose bands are absent. So the place from where the anther dehiscence takes place is called as the stomium. And stomium is the place found on the endothecium where the fibrous thickenings and the callose bands are totally absent. Are you getting? And one more thing, you must remember this thing, because many times I have seen that question is asked, that endothecium becomes hygroscopic in nature. Endothecium becomes hygroscopic in nature due to the presence of the fibrous thickening, due to the presence of the fibrous thickenings of made up of alpha cellulose, and thus helps in dehiscence of anther. Remember this thing, that when we will be studying about, when I will be uploading a video on the dehiscence of the anther, I will, in that video, I will say that how the endothecium layer, which is hygroscopic in nature, help in the anther dehiscence. In that video, I will be telling you in details. So endothecium becomes hygroscopic in nature due to the presence of the fibrous thickenings, due to the presence of the fibrous thickening, and thus it helps in dehiscence of anther. Means altogether, we can say that the layer which is helpful in the dehiscence of the anther is the endothecium. So epidermis was having the protective function, and the endothecium is chiefly meant for the dehiscence of the anther. Fine. Now, middle layers. Now, just below the endothecium are the middle layers. So middle layers are present between the endothecium and the tapetum, because just below the middle layers is the tapetum and just above the middle layers is the endothecium. So endothecium, in between the endothecium and the tapetum, what are present? Middle layers are present. Now, middle layers are 1-3 celled thick structure. They are not single celled structure. Middle layers are 1-3 celled thick structure present below the endothecium, which is visible in the diagram. Middle layer consists of the parenchymatous cells. Always remember that middle layer is made up of parenchymatous cells, and food is stored by the parenchymatous cells in this layer. Food is stored by parenchymatous cells in this layer. Now remember this thing, though we know very well that tapetum is nutritive in function. We always say that the developing microspores are provided nutrients by the tapetum layer. But the tapetum layer takes the nutrition from the middle layers. Tapetum layer takes nutrition from the middle layers. Okay. So food is stored by the parenchymatous cells in this layer. At the time of the maturity, what happens that these middle layers will disintegrate and will provide nutrition to the tapetum. And tapetum will provide nutrition to the microspores. So food is stored by the parenchymatous cells in this layer. Now, very, very important, middle layer is ephemeral. Remember this term. Middle layer is ephemeral. Ephemeral means it is short-lived in nature and is absent in the mature anther. Remember this thing, that in a mature anther, always middle layer is absent. Why? Because at the time of the maturity, the middle layers provide the food to the tapetum and later on disintegrate. Okay. Now, coming to the last layer, that is known as the tapetum, and this tapetum layer is the innermost layer which is surrounding the sporogenous tissue or microspore mother cell, which will undergo later on meiotic division to form the microspore. So I can say that here the microspores are there, and these microspores are provided nutrients by the tapetum layer. So tapetum layer is the innermost layer. It is the innermost layer surrounding the anther, and it is the most important layer. And you must remember this thing, that it is a single layer thick. Again, it is a single layer thick, and it acts as a nutritive layer. Always remember that it acts as a nutritive layer and provide nutrition to the developing microspores. The cells of this layers are having this. The cells of this tapetum layer are having large nuclei. They are having large nuclei and dense cytoplasm. They are having large nuclei and dense cytoplasm. Remember, the cells of the tapetum are having large nuclei and dense cytoplasm. And cells of the tapetum are initially diploid. Very, very important thing. The cells of the tapetum are initially diploid. This question is asked in examination, but later on become polyploid. But later on become polyploid and multinucleate due to endomitosis. Due to endomitosis and free nuclear division. Means initially the cells of the tapetum are diploid, but they become polyploid. Now the question arises that who makes the cells of the tapetum polyploid? So polyploid condition is made by endomitosis. Now let me tell you about the endomitosis. Have you heard about the endomitosis? What is endomitosis? Endomitosis is the chromosome duplication. Remember this thing. Chromosome duplication. What is endomitosis? Chromosome duplication as well as the separation of the chromatids occur within the intact nuclear membrane. Means during the endomitosis, the nuclear membrane never disintegrate. In normal mitosis, you have seen that at the end of the prophase, what happens? That the nuclear membrane disintegrate. But in endomitosis, the nuclear membrane does not disintegrate. The nuclear membrane is intact, and remaining inside the nuclear membrane, only inside the nucleus, the chromosome duplication as well as the separation of the chromatids occur. And because of which condition? And remember this thing, that very, very important thing is that during endomitosis, spindle fibers are not formed. And if spindle fibers will not be formed, then it's quite natural that the chromosomes will not moving towards the poles. And if they will be not moving towards the poles, then the diploid condition will be developed into the polyploid condition. And also, at the time of the maturity, the tapetum cells also become multinucleate. Now the condition arises that why they become multinucleate? Because of the free nuclear divisions. Because of the free nuclear divisions. Okay. And what is the chief function? What is the chief function of the tapetum? It absorbs food from the middle layers. We know very well that in the parenchymatous cells of the middle layers, what is stored? Food is stored. But at the time of the maturity, the middle layers will disintegrate, will provide nutrition, will provide food to the tapetum cells. So it absorbs food from the middle layers and provide nutrition to the microspore. Hence it is called as a nutritive layer. But one thing, students, to be noted here is that the tapetum is very, very important layer. In generally in NCRT and all, you can see that there is only one function given of the tapetum. The tapetum is nutritive in function and it provides nutrition to the developing microspore. But not only this, tapetum is also having many roles. Tapetum releases enzymes, tapetum releases hormones, tapetum can form pollen kit. Okay, so there are a lot of functions. There are a lot of functions of the tapetum, right? Today I have just discussed the general role of the tapetum, which is the nutrition, right? Not only this, the tapetum is of two types. There is two types of the tapetum. One is known as the amoeboid tapetum, which is called as the primitive type of the tapetum. And another is known as the advanced type of the tapetum, known as the secretory tapetum. The most common type of the tapetum is the secretory tapetum. So what are the two different types of the tapetums? What are the other functions of the tapetum other than the nutrition? Right? So this we'll be discussing in a separate video, because tapetum is not so small. It has many functions. So keep watching my videos. Wait for the next video. I will be uploading soon a video for the rest portion of the tapetum. So thanks a lot.